Very good morning to everyone. We are here with yet another session, and this session is very unique in the way we are presenting because it is from a student, or just it will be the represented in that format. And I'll introduce today's speaker with all of you. Her name is Arzu Goyal. She completed her graduation from Punjab Agriculture University, Ludhiana, in nutrition and dietetics, and she has done her internship from the Christian Medical College, Ludhiana, and she is a member of the Indian Dietetic Association. So I welcome you from our team On Your Growth to this platform. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the introduction. And I am very pleased to be here and share my views. So shall I start?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so today I'll be discussing about feeding mind, a nutritional approach towards mental well-being. We know that in today's scenario, mental health is so important. With the pandemic going on, everybody is very anxious and distressed about what will happen and if they are safe or not. You know, there's very much anxiousness going on. So how we can tackle it, how is diet related to it, and everything today, I'll try to link it. So before starting, I would like to start with a questionnaire. I would ask you a few questions and you have to answer yourself fully, honestly. And you can answer it according to the frequency with which it happens. Like if it happens rarely or it happens very frequently, oftenly, okay? So answer it to yourself and be honest. First, I was intolerant of anything that kept me from getting on with what I was doing. I couldn't seem to experience any positive feeling at all. I was unable to become enthusiastic about anything. I felt scared without any good reason. I experienced trembling, like in the hands. I experienced breathing difficulty, even though there was no physical exertion. I felt downhearted and blue. I found it difficult to work up the initiative to do things. I found it difficult to relax. I found myself getting agitated or irritated very easily. Okay, now after this, these are the few questions related to diet, and you have to answer it in the same way that how often do you do it? First is I crave sugar-loaded products like cakes, pastries, etc. a lot. I drink a cup of coffee more than twice a day. I sleep for 8 hours most nights. I consume processed foods daily, like if it is refined flour or packaged foods, etc. I eat leafy green vegetable at least once a week. I exercise at least 3 times a week. I practice mindfulness, yoga, meditation, walking, anything more than 3 times a week. I include good quality omega-3 in my diet. Now you would be wondering why I am asking all these questions. It's because I want to paint a picture in your mind that if the answers to my former questions were mostly yes, then what all you can change or change in your lifestyle and find a solution to the problem you are facing. I hope that I am able to help that by the end of my session. Okay, now we know that it is well known that what we eat has a big impact on our physical health, including the risk of developing chronic diseases like diabetes or cardiovascular diseases like high blood pressure or heart attack, heart problems, etc., or digestive issues like indigestion or acidity, etc. It obviously leads to obesity. It is very well known, and it also leads to cancer. But does diet has any effect on the brain? New and emerging research has suggested that dietary patterns are associated with mental health. Certain ways that diet has been shown to impact mental health are through inflammation or oxidative stress or our hippocampal volume. Let's see that how it affects. Now we know that mainly we consume, there are two types of diets, okay? So one is a diet which is rich in fats, which is rich in refined sugar and which is rich in carbohydrates. So we say that that it is a Western diet, which is rich in burgers or pizzas. Okay, and the second is which is rich in vegetables and fruits and whole grains and healthy fats, which is a balanced diet. So we'll see that how it affects that, what type of food affects our inflammation, oxidative stress, and etc. So first is inflammation. It is seen that high levels of inflammation have been linked to depression. Okay, so consuming diet which is rich in high in fats and refined carbohydrate, it increases your risk to inflammation, thus leading to death of the brain cells. But if you consume a balanced diet, and a balanced diet decreases the stress. Third is the hippocampal volume. What is hippocampus? Hippocampus is actually a part of the brain which is responsible for rich in carbohydrates, etc. It decreases the hippocampal volume. Whereas when we eat a diet which is rich in balanced, which is rich and balanced with nutrients, it increases the hippocampal volume, which is linked to improved mental well-being. What does this mean? What do I mean when I say this? Is that the foods we eat can have an impact on the size of our brain function, and our mental well-being. Now, do you know that if you remove all the moisture out of your brain and break it down to its nutritional components, you will find that most of the weight of our brain is composed of fats or lipids. Okay, and the remaining brain matter, it is constituted of protein or amino acids, and rest is made up of glucose and micronutrients. Now, of course, the brain is more than just some of its nutritional constituents, but each component does have a distinctive impact on the functioning, development, mood, and energy. That is why, you know, you feel very lethargic or very energetic after you eat. So it has a direct impact on our brain and how it functions. So out of all the fatty acids, essential fatty acids are the superstar. Okay, it is composed of polyunsaturated fatty acids, omega-3 and omega-6. Now the brain is one of the organs with the highest level of lipids. Brain lipids, these are composed of fatty acids. Fatty acids are the structural constituents of membranes. It has been estimated that gray matter contains 50% fatty acids that are polyunsaturated in nature. So, you know that for the proper maintenance and the formation of the cell membranes, you need to have good amount of essential fatty acids in your diet. But exactly what essential fatty acids is that essential fatty acids cannot be produced by our body. So it needs to be procured from outside, like from the diet you have to consume it. So essential fatty acids are of two types, omega-3 and omega-6. From where you can get it, omega-3 sources include fish and other seafood, nuts and seeds like flax seeds, chia seeds, walnuts, plant oils such as flaxseed oil or soya bean oil or canola oil. Omega-6 sources, they include tofu, sunflower oil, canola oil, peanut butter, etc. Now, coming to proteins. We know that proteins are the building block nutrients. You know, they help in self-differentiation and growth. So, but do you know that they also manipulate how we feel and behave? Now we know that a high quality protein diet, it contains all essential amino acids like egg. It contains almost all essential amino acids, the animal sources. But plant proteins such as beans, peas, grains, they are low in one or two essential amino acids. So they need to be supplemented with one another so that we can have a complete plate of our essential amino acids. Protein intake and in turn, the individual amino acids, they can affect the brain functioning and mental health. How? Let's see. Now, we know that proteins are built up of amino acids, right? Now, amino acids contain the precursors to neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters are the chemical messengers that carry signals between neurons, affecting things like mood, sleep, attentiveness, etc. Now, the neurotransmitter, you must have heard about serotonin or dopamine, etc. What are they made up of? They are made up of amino acids. So the neurotransmitter dopamine is made from amino acid tyrosine, and the neurotransmitter serotonin is made from tryptophan. If there is lag in any of these two amino acids, there will not be enough synthesis of the respective neurotransmitter. So it is quite obvious that if you are not giving the source for the formation of these neurotransmitters, of course your mood will be affected. You will feel agitated, you will feel aggressive, or you will feel very low, because the neurotransmitters are not forming in your body because there is no ample amount of amino acids present in your body. Now, let's see some of the neurotransmitters, their functions and the precursors, you know, from what they are made, the essential amino acids from which they are made. First is adrenaline, which is a flight or fight hormone. You know, when you're in a stressful condition, this is a neurotransmitter which is produced. Its precursor is tyrosine. Noradrenaline, which is a concentration hormone, or dopamine, which is a pleasure hormone, that is when you exercise or when you do something, you eat something that, you know, makes you feel happy, dopamine is released. So it is also made from tyrosine. So you need to have a good amount of tyrosine in your body to produce these. Next is serotonin, which is a mood hormone, which regulates your mood, your happiness, etc. It's known as happy hormone. It affects your sleep cycle and digestive system regulation, and it is also affected by exercise, etc. It is made from tryptophan. Next is GABA, which is a calming neurotransmitter. It calms your central nervous system and it helps to improve focus, or at low levels can cause anxiety. Whenever you feel anxious, it is because there is low levels of GABA in your body. It is made from glutamate. Okay. And then is acetylcholine, which is involved in the learning process and memory process. It is made from choline, and then is memory neurotransmitter, that is glutamate, which is involved in learning, memory, regulate development and creation of nerve contacts, which is whose precursor is glutamate. There was a study which indicated that a person who was anxious, when he was given glutamate, he showed a calming effect. You know, he was not so anxious. He himself said that, you know, he's feeling more calm and less anxious because he consumed glutamate. So next is carbohydrates. Now we know that most of the energy that we obtain, 60 to 70% of the food we eat and energy we obtain, it is from carbohydrates. Right, our brain also needs energy. From where does it come? It comes from the glucose. Our brain can only absorb glucose for energy. So now, how is it essential for our brain functional mood regulation, etc.? It is because now eating a meal which is rich in carbohydrate, it triggers the release of insulin in the body, right? Now, insulin, it helps let blood sugar into the cells where it can be used for energy. Now, insulin is used by our body for producing energy. Now, simultaneously, what is happening is that it triggers the entry of tryptophan in the brain. Now, tryptophan in the brain affects the neurotransmitter levels. Of course, I have told you earlier that tryptophan is used in the formation of serotonin, which is a happy hormone. That is why you feel very happy when you eat something, because it triggers the entry of tryptophan, which further makes serotonin. Consumption of diets low in carbohydrate tends to precipitate depression, since the production of brain chemicals, serotonin and tryptophan, that promote the feeling of well-being is triggered by carbohydrate-rich foods. So if you're not eating your food, or you're eating food which is, you know, less in carbohydrates, etc., you don't feel happy, or you feel very anxious, very irritated. Okay, you don't have that calming effect. Now, we know that carbohydrates, they are of two types. One is high GI and second is a low GI. Now, what are high GI? High GI is that it is a high glycemic index food. So what is that? Is that when you consume a food which is rich in, which has a lot of carbohydrates and which is high in glycemic index, it increases your blood sugar levels very rapidly. The amount of glucose in your blood is very high when you consume a diet which is rich in high GI foods. So now what happens is you consume something which is high GI, like you consume chips or pastries or biscuits, potatoes, or processed food, you know, which are very high in refined flour. These are very easily absorbed by our body, very easily, you know, they flow into the blood, they are absorbed by the blood. And now blood has absorbed the glucose further. Now insulin is released in the body. Insulin will produce tryptophan, which will accelerately, मतलब sharply, it will increase the level of tryptophan in your body. You know, in the brain, there is high peak of tryptophan in the brain. So at once you will feel very good after consuming it. But then the rise is so high that it will fall tremendously. After some time, you'll again feel low after eating high GI foods. क्योंकि एकदम it went up and then suddenly it came down. Okay. So the level is not very constant. Second, when you eat low GI foods, like which is rich in fiber, or you have whole grain bread or lentils, your pulses, dal, etc., or basmati rice, brown rice, vegetables, they are low in GI. So they increase the level of sugar in your blood, but the rise is not that much. No, it is very constant. The level is constant. So the level of tryptophan which is being released is constant. You feel the same throughout after having your meal. You know, there will be not a sharp rise or a decline in your mood. Now, what about meal time? Okay, if you consume low GI food, it's good. Now, does it affect that at what time you're having your meal? The answer is yes. Now, we know that food is our body's main fuel, right? And we need to top it up regularly with a balance of food groups to keep blood sugar levels stable. Now, we know that why blood sugar level is important. Now, what happens if you don't eat regularly? So nowadays, what is the scenario that everyone is so busy, they mostly skip meal. You know, they skip breakfast because they have to rush to the offices, or, you know, children, they rush to schools. And everybody, it has become a habit of, you know, not consuming breakfast nowadays. So it is rightly said that breakfast is a very important meal of the day. You know, you have slept all night and your body now needs energy. It is saying to you that eat something, but you are completely avoiding it. So what happens now? You have skipped breakfast and now you feel tired all day. Lunchtime came, you're feeling very hungry and you had a big, you know, good high amount of sugars that gives you, you know, energy to, you feel full after eating. You'd have very heavy lunch. Okay. And now your blood sugar has rose. Now what will happen after some time? It will again go down so steeply that you will again feel agitated. Now what happens is you will feel hangry. What is hangry? That it is when you are hungry, you feel angry. So there is a term known as hangry. No, you must have seen the advertisement on the TV, which is like a person who is very grumpy. And his friend says, okay, you are hangry, just eat it. And he eats it and then he's feeling very calm and, you know, okay and all. So because he was hangry, there was no sugar, no glucose in his blood. And, you know, the body was saying, I need energy. And so after eating, he feels good. So you had your snack, and then after dinner you had a good dinner, heavy dinner, and then you again feel lethargic. Are you seeing the cycle I'm saying? So it is very important to eat your meals at regular time so that you have a constant mood all over the day and you don't feel hangry, irritated, etc. Now I have talked about most all of the macronutrients, the carbohydrate, role of carbohydrates or protein and the fats, which are essential for brain health. Now micronutrients also play a very important role in your brain health. Vitamin D, vitamin E, B1, B2, B3, B6, B12. What they do is they help in the production of neurotransmitters, or they act as coenzymes, which in one way or another helps in the production or absorption of tryptophan, etc., which helps in producing the neurotransmitters. So they should be included in your diet. Then folic acid, pantothenic acid, calcium, magnesium, zinc, iron, selenium. These are also antioxidants. You know, they help to fight the oxidative stress happening in the body, in your brain or body. And they reduce the inflammation, maintaining the brain health. So it is very important to have all the macronutrients in your diet too. Micronutrients in your diet, sorry. So what are the sources? The sources of micronutrients, vitamin C, we know that it is obtained from citrus fruits, oranges or guava. Amla is very good source of vitamin C. Vitamin B12, it is mostly obtained from animal sources like fish, poultry, dairy. Vitamin A, it is obtained from egg yolk, carrot, sweet potato, you know, all the red, green leafy vegetables, yellow vegetables, the colored vegetables. Then vitamin D, we obtain it from fatty fish and mushrooms and milk, fortified cereals, etc. Iron, you can obtain it from red meat or lentils, etc. Vitamin B6, folate, it is obtained from chickpea, spinach, beetroot. Calcium, dairy is very good source, you know, milk and its products, paneer, are very good source of calcium, or sesame seeds, they are a good source of calcium. Magnesium, you can obtain it from green leafy vegetables like spinach and legumes, nuts, seeds, whole grains. Dark chocolate is also a very good source of magnesium. You know, you must have seen that when you feel very stressed, you eat dark chocolate, you feel fine. Why is that? Because it contains a good amount of magnesium. Next is zinc. Sources of zinc can be red meat, poultry, nuts like cashews, almonds, mushrooms. Now, there are many studies that say that having a diet which is rich in antioxidants, like if you're consuming fruits, vegetables, etc., they have a positive effect on your brain health. Like many studies were conducted related to depression and anxiety, that is there any effect on the patients who are suffering from depression, anxiety? So this is one study. It was conducted in vivo conditions. And what was the result was that to the rats, which they fed polyphenols obtained from parsley, they had less anxiolytic behavior. That is, they were less anxious as compared to those which were placebo, who were not fed with polyphenols. And for antidepressant behavior, the same was the result. That is, they were able to be less depressed, or they were able to cope up with the situation well. Now, instead of all this, what are our teens eating nowadays? We see a huge amount of, you know, crowd, mostly teenagers, in front of fast food, shops, etc. They are so, if the word is right, they are so addicted to having the processed food, you know, burgers, pizzas. Everybody is consuming, you know, Maggie, etc., which is rich in refined products, you know, refined carbohydrates. That you must have seen that today the youth is more agitated, you know, they feel more irritated, they have very less patience, they can't hear anything. So I think diet has a role in it, because they are rushing towards the unhealthy, you know, the foreign diet, Western diet. So it is very important to inculcate healthy eating habits from childhood, so that there is a healthy brain development. A Mediterranean diet, it is becoming very popular, you know, nowadays. So Mediterranean diet was actually originated in the Mediterranean region, and it had very good physiological aspects. You know, many studies have shown that it has positive effect on the cardiovascular, heart disease, diabetes, etc. But there are many studies which says that it has a positive effect on our brain health too. So why is it so popular is that Mediterranean diet, it promotes the consumption of whole grains, pulses, vegetables, fruits, you know, olive oils, the essential fatty acids. They say that you should consume nuts daily. Have one time, include legumes and seeds, etc. That you should at least have fish and seafood twice each week. And they most important is they also focus on doing a physical activity. And most importantly, say you to enjoy the meal with your family. You know that it has a very positive effect. When you enjoy the meal with your family, when you talk to them, you share something, there are many happy hormones releasing in your body. So this is also a study which said that it was conducted in Iranian adults who were aged between 18 to 55 years. And they used food frequency questionnaire and they assessed their dietary intakes, that what if they adhere to Mediterranean diet, what happened to their, if there was depression seen in these patients or not. And it was measured, and what was the result was that the participants with the greatest adherence to the Mediterranean diet, they had lower odds for depression, whereas those who had lower adherence, you know, the one who were eating Mediterranean diet, they were good to, they were having low odds of developing anxiety or depression, etc., in contrast to those who were not consuming it. So I would like to end it with a few health eating habits. First, my tip number one is that eat regular, have balanced meals. You know, include a rainbow in your plate. It is rightly said that include a rainbow in your plate. Include vegetables and include fruits, include lentils and cereals, etc. Have a good, include prebiotics, yogurt, etc. So that you have each and every nutrient on your plate at one time, you know, and don't skip meals. It is very important today that don't skip meals. Eat regularly, eat frequently, eat after every 2 to 3 hours, have little snacks, healthy snacks, which are rich in carbohydrate, healthy carbohydrates and protein, and eat frequently. Second tip is make whole or minimal processed foods the basis of your diet. Try that you include less processed foods in your diet. Third is develop practice and share cooking skills. Now, it is very important, you know, nowadays everyone is busy. Everyone is working. So they have very less time to cook for themselves. So they are running towards convenience foods. But we know that they are processed and they are not good. You know, they're at one time, at one way you are having home cooked healthy foods, on the other side you are having these convenience foods which are processed at one point or another. So it is very important to bring back the old habits of cooking. So, you know, you yourself cook the food, you know from where it is coming, how you are preparing, you yourself take in, if you yourself take interest, you will naturally find, you know, alternative ways. So I can make this healthy by adding this or doing this. We can make it. I would advise that, you know, be in the kitchen with your mother when she is preparing something. You will see the beauty that, okay, now she is adding this, now she is doing this. Okay, it is made from this. So you will see how it is made. You will feel good when you're eating it. The last tip is make mealtime a priority. Everyone is now rushing towards offices, etc. So instead of eating very, you know, sitting and eating, they developed a habit of just grabbing the food and going. You know, everything is, I know everyone is busy nowadays, but instead of making mealtime their priority, they are making everything else their priority. I would just like to say that listen to your body, you know, what it's saying, that I'm hungry, feed me. So just sit down, make it a priority, have meals with your family and have good breakfast, good lunch, eat snacks, eat healthy, have healthy options in your diet. So it is very important that you make food your priority. In the end, I would just like to say, which is a motto I think of every dietitian nutritionist, that let food be thy medicine, and thy medicine shall be thy food. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think it is a great session what we had just now. And it covers all the perspective which we are looking forward as a student also, and as what a whole perspective which covers research approach, which covers the general approach to the common people and to the students. So it covers a whole lot of perspectives. So I thank you for your wonderful sessions, what we can learn from you, and we can connect to you through another sessions with another topics, which would be more particular to learn. So thank you so much to come on our platform.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, and I hope this kind of presentations, it was not boring, because most of the time what happens, long presentation, people feel it is boring, same thing is repeating, but it was so connecting. Okay, I could not let my thoughts go. Okay, continue, be connected to the same. So hope it will be the same for everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you
so much. I hope I was able to justify.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you. Have a nice day.